announcement on Sunday, Father Ernie De Leon will turn 50 years old. Golden boy. And we'll celebrate his birthday. He will treat us to dinner tonight. Baka seryoso mga malakot na ba ito? Anyway, to focus now on youth catechesis and the new evangelization, of course, is our dear friend and partner of the UCAT Philippines, Father Richard Lagos of the Diocese of San Jose de Nueva Ecija. Please give him a round of applause.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. I'm a little bit nervous because the pillars of the Episcopal Commissions are here, especially of catechesis and Catholic education, especially bishop. So I was asked to present this topic for you also to be aware of what is this UCAT and what is UCAT Philippines doing in this apostolate for the evangelization. And tinatanong ako kanina ni Father Jesse kung it's the same talk that I gave in Mindoro. Sabi ko it's different kasi we are trying to go back dun sa pinagmulan ng catechesis. So, babalik muna tayo ng kaunti for us to understand clearly bakit o paano nagkaroon ng UCAT, DUCAT, and you will know later ano ba yung mga iba pang mga catechetical materials or tools that we can utilize for the evangelization of young people. And later on, second part will be, we will be teaching you the methodology proposed by Pope Benedict on how to use these tools and how these tools will be efficient in our evangelizing activities. So first, let us try to see catechesis in the light of the sacred scriptures. So konting baliktanaw lang muna po tayo. I know you have studied this already. You have a master's and doctoral degree here. So konting ano lang po, balik lang tayo. The word catechesis means instruction by word of mouth, especially by questioning and answering. It's a question and answer, not just like what Socrates did in his philosophical discussions, yung para na-defeat niya yung kanyang mga kalaban sa pamimilosofiya, yung mga rhetoricians, no? Through tinatawag ng Socratic dialogue. So yung pagtatanong and then sasagot. Kumbaga, you pretend that you know nothing. To know that you know nothing. So, para ikaw yung uhaw. It's, I think, the best way, the best method, I think, in catechesis is that when you are a catechist, you pretend that you know nothing. And you ask the person kung ano yung alam niya. No? Especially kung yung kausap mo, pilosopo. Mga kabataan niya, mga pilosopo. Pagkakausapin mo, I mean, also in youth ministry, at most of the time, pagka yung tatanong mo, isa, hindi sila interesado. Especially, we are in the postmodern time. And the famous tenet of the postmodern people is this, I don't care. Paano kung na-encounter mo mga kabataan ganito? So what? No, I don't care. So paano natin ipapahatid yung kahalagahan ng pananampalataya? So in the Old Testament, in the scriptures, makita na natin itong ganitong method of instructing people. So the question and answer. For example, in Exodus, it says, when your children ask you, what does this right of yours mean? And then you shall reply. Ito na yung answer. This is the Passover sacrifice of the Lord, who passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt. When he struck down the Egyptians, he spared our houses. So it's the way they catechize, the way they instruct, the way they teach their children is through question and answer. So as early as that, yung ganung methodology is already visible in the life of the Israelites. And in the book of Deuteronomy, it's very, alam natin ito, therefore you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. This is the content. And then sabi nila, take to your heart these words. Huh? Take to your hearts these words which I enjoin on you today. Drill them into your children. Drill them into your children. Speak of them at home and abroad. Whether you are busy or at rest, bind them at your wrist as a sign and let them be as a pendant on your forehead. Write them on the doorposts of your houses and on your gates. This, actually, is catechetical. No? Itong ganitong ginagawa nila, yung take to your heart, drill them, speak of them, bind them, and then write them. This is a catechetical method. No? So, catechetical instruction goes back to the earliest beginnings of Christian history in its basic character. It is simply the instruction of those being baptized. It's done as preparations for the reception of the sacrament of baptism, initiation. So, for example, meron po bang marunong tumasa ng Greek? Mga Bible scholars dito. So that you might know the exact truth about the things you have been. So, meron ng mentions, utterances of the word catechesis. So, this one, the inilagay ko na sa red, yung katekos, di ba? Katekes, yung red na yun. So, it's instruction. No? And also, this man had been instructed in the way of the Lord from Acts of the Apostles. Otos and katekemenos. Katekemenos. So, yung instructed. So, basically, katekemenos, katekestos ay instructions. Katekumenos, ito naman sa Galatians, katekumenos. Kateku, itong isa, katekunti. Katekunti. So, instructions, ito yung instructed and instructor. So, may mga utterances. Pagdating na tayo ng mga, nasa Bible pa yan. Yeah. So, there are three forms of catechesis in the Old Testament and in the Jewish context. So, first is the domestic catechesis. It is conducted by the head of the family for the benefit of his children and servants. There is also scholastic catechesis done by teachers in the schools, and also ecclesiastical catechesis by priests and Levites in the temple and the synagogues. So, iba't-ibang kumbaga, levels of catechesis, also even in the time of Jesus, no? So, the proselytes, the converts to the Jewish religion, were carefully instructed before being admitted to becoming members of the Jewish faith. So, meron din silang catechetical instructions. And in fact, Jesus, at the age of 12, started that process of being catechized, being instructed. So, the story when he was lost in the temple and was found by his parents. And Jesus, during his public life, frequently made use of catechetical method to impart instructions. He used a lot of images. Like, for example, when he wanted, in the Gospel of John especially, like the I am sayings of Jesus, I am the light of the world, I am the good shepherd, I am the vine, I am... So he used a lot of images. And also, parables. Parables are catechetical, no? So yung pamamaraan ni Jesus is actually catechetical because this is the language wherein ordinary people can understand. Simple language, simple examples. Of course, dito na kay Jesus iikot yung ating model of evangelization. But you have to move forward. So, in the Acts of the Apostles, you see, when they had been convinced, sabi dito, of this truth and had compunction in their heart for their crime, they asked, "What shall we do?" Question. And Peter answered, "Do penance and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins." And with very many other words, did he testify and exhort them. So, makita na natin dito at this early stage, the contents of catechesis. And what are those contents? Doctrinal and moral. No? So, sabi ni St. Peter doon, ang gagawin, do penance and be baptized. Repentance first, and then be baptized, faith, no? So, should be moral and then doctrinal. St. Stephen goes further and brings out that belief in Jesus as the Christ meant the ending of the old covenant and the coming of in of a new. Napakahalaga nung instructor and instructed. Napakahalaga nung communicator and the one who is receiving the communication. Kasi makikita natin throughout the history of catechesis, nag-a-adjust yung methodology, nag-a-adjust yung approach, nag-iiba-iba based on the situation and based on the audience. Like for example, this one. So Saint Philip, the deacon, preached of the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus Christ for that Samaritan. Imagine that the Samaritans are not Jews. So basically, the Samaritans are enemies of the Jewish people. So ang approach ni Saint Philip the deacon is to preach the kingdom of God because that is the main concern of the Samaritans. So ano yung pangangailangan ng audience mo? And then ang result, they were baptized, both men and women. So yung experience also of Saint Philip with the eunuch, no? So yung content ng preaching ni Saint Philip is only proof from the scripture, no mention of penance and repentance. Why? Because the eunuch is a just man. Parang hindi naman niya kailangan na i-preach kasi sinasabuhay niya na yung penance na yun, no? Yung, kumbaga, ang kailangan noong eunuch is the proof from the scripture. Yun na lang yung kailangan niya. Kaya ito lang itinuro ni Philip. And in Acts chapter 10, the discourse, makita na natin dun yung articles of the faith. So the development. So pagdating doon sa Acts chapter 10, malinaw na nandun na yung God, Jesus Christ, as Lord of all things, and then the Holy Ghost. And then nandun na yung crucifixion, yung death and resurrection of our Lord, and His coming to judge the living and the dead, and the remission of sins. So basically, doon sa Acts chapter 10, makikita natin doon yung framework of the existing creed that we have right now. And these are also the subject of St. Paul's discourses. No? So pag siya ay nagtuturo doon sa kanyang mga mission areas, laging nandoon yung content of the creed about Christ, the Trinity, remission of sins, and then baptism. So as he himself summed up the matter, he taught publicly. So ito yung method ni St. Paul in evangelization. He taught publicly and from house to house, nagbabahay-bahay. A few days ago, Bishop Bobek shared about the experience of one of our priests in the diocese, nagbabahay-bahay, no? as a way of evangelizing the parish. So ganito yung ginawa ni St. Paul, testifying both to the Jews and Gentiles, penance towards God, and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. So ito rin yung experience ni Apollo. Apollo, he was instructed in the way of the Lord. So instruction. And then, itong si Priscilla and Aquila, sila yung nag-expound nung pananampalataya na natanggap ni Apollo kay St. Paul, no? And then, makita na natin dito, may involvement na. Aside from Paul, nandiyan na si Priscilla and si Aquila na nag-expound noong pananampalataya. Sabi nito, diligently, acribesteron. Diligently. Maybe it is one of the methods that we need to also have, no? Yung diligence in evangelization, in catechesis. So, what about the time of the Church Fathers? So, the first catechetical material after the Gospels, no, after the New Testament, is, I think, the Didache. And the Didache, you find little but moral instruction. Hindi about doctrinal, but more on moral. Why? Because it is clear that those to whom it is addressed must have already received some knowledge of what they were to believe. Kasi if you read the Didache, it's about the way of life and the way of death, the path to darkness and the path to light, no? So yung ways, two ways, light and darkness, death and life, no? And also Justin the Martyr, yung kanyang apologies, so makita natin nagkaroon na ng shift sa evangelization. So dumidepende siya sa audience. For example, sa apologies, kasi during that time, madami ito na yung nag-uusbungan yung mga heresies, mga false teachings, o yung mga misleading na mga katuroan. So the task of the apologist is to remove prejudices against Christianity and to set forth its doctrines and practices in such a way as to appeal to the fair-minded pagan. So the audience are the pagan. If anyone was moved to embrace the true religion, he was not at once admitted as in the days of the apostles. So yung mga apostles kasi, binyag lang sila ng binyag eh. Pag may sinabi ko, kasi gusto kong maging Kristiyano, at that very moment, bibinyag na. Pero during the time of the apologists, especially the time of Justin the Martyr, naging maingat ang simbahan in receiving yung mga gustong maging Kristiyano. No? May reason. No? So dumadaan sa mga proseso na. Ito, si St. Cyril of Jerusalem, in his catechetical lectures, nakagawa siya ng 24 catechetical discourses forming together a complete course of moral and doctrinal instructions. So meron siyang pro-catechesis, catechesis, and then catechesis mystagogy. So imagine yung kanyang ginawa na to. And then si St. Augustine of Hippo, yung De Catechizandis Rudibus. So there are 27 chapters. The contents are about theory and practice of catechesis. The theory and the practice of catechesis. Okay, or natin. Dumating yung time na ang Christians were persecuted. So because of the early Christian persecutions, na iba na naman yung approach ng evangelization, ng catechesis. Kasi, iba yung time na nag-uumpisa sila. Ngayon, flourishing na ang Christianity, pero ito yung background, dark background of evangelization, yung Christian persecutions ng mga Roman emperors. No? So, because of that, they instituted yung catechumenate. Doon nag-umpisa yung catechumenate, yung preparation for baptism, and also the discipline of the secret. Why? It became necessary. It became necessary in the age of Christian persecution to exercise great caution in admitting persons to membership in the church. Why? Because of the danger of falling away or even of betrayal must be guarded against by a careful doctrinal and moral teaching. Kasi, bakit kailangan i-strengthen yung doctrinal and moral training? Kasi yung tendency, yung danger of baka merong mag-betray o kailangan convince sila sa kanilang pananampalataya. At malinaw sa kanilang pananampalataya nila para mawala yung danger of yung falling away and yung betrayal. Kasi, syempre, persecuted nga sila. So, mas in-strengthen nila yung doctrinal and moral training. And, nagkaroon na ng initiation process. Yung mahabang process kahapon, Father Dex mentioned some about the preparations for baptism, especially during yung adult baptism during Easter. So, at first, yung applicant, yung gustong maging Kristiyano, they were treated as inquirer. And only the fundamental doctrines were communicated to him. Fundamental, kumbaga patikim-tikim pa lang doon sa pananampalata, hindi pa yung kabuuan. And then as soon as he had given proof of his knowledge and fitness, he was admitted to the catechumenate. Ito na, tatawagin na siyang catechumenate. And was further instructed. May mga level, degree of instruction sila. And then, later on, after some years, hindi months, hindi days, kundi after some years spent in this stage, he was promoted to the ranks of the competentes. Those ready for baptism, as might be expected, he was now instructed more specifically in the rites for this purpose. So medyo liturgical na, ritualistic na yung catechesis, yung sinasabi ni Father Dex na liturgical catechesis, no? So even when he had been initiated, kahit na nabinyagan na siya, quote, initiated, his instruction was not yet at an end. Ito yung sinasabi rin ni Father Dex kahapon, nakakalungkot sa atin ngayon, after baptism, wala nang further instruction. Doon na natatapos. Eh, mga bata pa ito, adult baptism to eh. No? Kasi wala, hindi pa allowed during this time yung infant baptism, only adult baptism. So meron pang continuing program, instructions even after baptism. So, the distinction between the elementary and advanced instruction is noted by St. Paul in his letter to the Corinthians. He said, as unto little ones in Christ, I gave you milk to drink, not meat, for you were not able as yet. So, kinukunsin na pang bata pa, baby pa, kaya milk muna. Kaya hindi pa pwedeng karne at baka hindi matunawan. So, during the time of Constantine the Great, we knew that in our church history, that Constantine was converted to Christianity. And when he was converted, no? Noong 313, yung Edict of Milan, ang ginawa niya, yung he decreed the tolerance of Christianity in the empire. Hindi pa official religion, no? It was a misunderstanding that Christianity became the official religion of the Roman Empire during the time of Constantine. Not yet. Ang ginawa lang ni Constantine ay yung tolerance that he allowed Christianity to flourish in the Roman Empire. Okay? I heard a story that Constantine was baptized before his death. Kasi believing that pag binindagan ka, lahat ng kasalanan mo, mawawash away. Kaya very wise itong si Constantine, at pag binindag siya bago siya mamatay, siguro humakong na ng maraming kasalanan. Okay. He called the First Council of Nicaea in 325, at which the Nicene Creed was adopted by Christians. So doon na, medyo nabuo na yung Articles of the Faith, yung Nicene Creed, sa the time of Constantine. And then, dito na, yung sa, sumunod sa kanya, si Emperor Theodosius, siya na yung nag-issue ng decree that effectively made Orthodox Nicene Christianity as the official state religion of the whole Roman Empire. So it was Theodosius. Tama ako, mother na. Tinanong ako ni mother niya nung nandun siya sa room niya. Wow. Para akong nag-comprehensive exam sa kanya over the phone. Okay. And during the Roman Empire, since Christianity became the official religion of the whole empire, imagine, mass baptism. Kasi kung ano yung religion of the emperor, should be the religion of the people. So that is why from BEC model of the church, the Domus Ecclesiae, no? From house churches, household churches, imagine, because of what happened during the time of Theodosius, you must baptism, whether you like it or not, if you are under the Roman Empire, by force, you have to be converted to Christianity. Kaya imagine yung paano nila ginawa, yung catechesis doon. Yung iba kahit ayaw nilang maging Kristiyano, magpapabinyag sila. So mass baptism happened, and basilicas was converted to cathedrals. No? Yung mga papal courts was converted to churches, like yung Santa Maria Maggiore, di ba? Laki-laki. So it's really actually originally a papal imperial court, no? Na converted into basilica, church, cathedral. So, nag-iba na rin yung pamamaraan ng evangelization and catechesis. So the prolonged period of trial and instruction no longer existed. Hindi kagaya nung ang simbahan ay persecuted pa. So ngayon, madalian na lang. Kasi mass baptism ito. Imagine kung ikakatechize mo, ilibo-libo, daan-daan mga tao. So imagine, no? So ihanda mo for baptism. So madalian. Parang siguro istay natin ngayon pagka daan-daan ng mga bibinyagan, talagang madalian na. So, and has fuller teaching on the subject of original sin leading to the administration of baptism to infants. Ito, inalaw na yung infant baptism. And godparents are instructed in the name of the child. So as the child grew, it was taught its religion both at home and at the services in the church. So this instruction was necessarily more simple than that formerly given to grown-up catechumens and gradually came to be what we now understand by catechetical instruction. So dito na nag-umpisa. So ito yung sinasabi nilang golden ages of the church. No? Talaga namang nag-flourish ang Christianity, nakabuo ng civilization from different places. Pero dumating yung barbarian invasion. At ang ginawa na naman nila, lahat ng established ng Roman Empire, sinira, no? Mga churches, libraries, schools, lahat ay halos walang iniwan. So, ang simbahan has to adjust again. Paano siya makaka-cope up? Kaya nga yung ano, di ba, yung mga ang natira na lang yata nag-aaral that time, after that, yung mga monks na lang. Yung mga nandun sa kasi sila na lang yung may access sa books. Sila na lang may access sa mga libraries, no? So, iba na naman yung tempo ng kanilang evangelization efforts, no? So, the instruction had to be of an elementary character. No? Kasi yung mga tao, hindi naman na nag-aaral. The missionaries had to go back to the methods of the apostles. Ano ba yung method of the apostles? Gaya na ginawa ni Peter, talagang person to person and then layman's term, talagang simple language. So the content speaks of renunciation of idolatry and profession of belief in the great truths of Christianity. Religious instruction did not cease with baptism. Hindi na lang doon na tatapos. So said sermons were rarer than in our time. The priest spoke rather as a catechist than as a preacher. So yung mga pare, ginamit talaga nila yung catechetical approach method, hindi yung pagiging homiletic style natin na napakalalalim at napakalalahawak. So, bumalik sila doon sa ganoong method. Later on, itong si St. Edmund Rich was able to create a catechetical material. He wrote Familiar Instruction on Prayer, Seven Deadly Sins, the Commandments, and the Sacraments. Let's go to the 14th century. Ito na yung invention of printing and the revival of learning. Ito na, unti-unti na namang nag-aral yung mga tao. Medyo na nakikita na ulit yung importance of learning. Kasi for so long a time, after the barbarian invasions, so, sinira ang mga schools, no? So, walang access sa books. Ngayon, ito na, because of the invention of printing. So, meron na ulit mga libro. Kasi dati, mga copies, unwritten na, ngayon may printing press na. So, si John Gerson, he realized that the much-needed reform of the church should begin by the instruction of the young. And though he was chancellor of the University of Paris, he devoted himself to this work. He composed a sort of a little catechism entitled The ABC of Simple Folk. Martin Luther, the famous Inquiridion, which was really the third edition of his smaller catechism, was published in 1529 and speedily ran through a number of editions. It is still used in Germany and in other Protestant countries. So Martin Luther placed extraordinary emphasis on the importance of catechesis and devoted himself to it with a will. His exhortation at the beginning of the large catechism is well worth the reading. Siguro, the word catechism is somewhat ecumenical in its sense because even the Lutherans, even the Protestants, Calvin also has the catechism. No? Although the content may be somewhat different, but the term catechism itself is actually ecumenical in its sense kasi meron silang catechesis. John Calvin, no? Meron siyang tinatawag na short and longer catechism. The founder of Calvinism. So, ano lang natin, para mabilis lang kasi medyo maraming slides kasi ito. He kindly admits that it was always the custom in the church to instruct children in this way. Of course, he takes care to introduce the chief points of his heresy. Although ginamit niya yung catechetical method, but it is to justify his heresies. So, they have to take note of that. Catechesis is also should have you know sound contents. Kasi the method of catechesis ginamit din niya ng mga Protestant leaders like Calvin and Martin Luther. No? But the content should be you know sound. So in 1647, the Westminster Assembly of Divines threw up the Presbyterian larger and smaller catechism. So they also have this. Catechetical materials. Ito yung sinasabi kasi naman they claim yung mga Protestants like Martin Luther and Calvin that ito yung nawala sa simbahan. Na ito yung pagkukulang ng simbahan because they were not able to reach the language of the ordinary people. Ito yung isa sa mga sinasabi ng mga Reformation. No? Where in fact, hindi naman totoo kasi Peter Canisius, also the Jesuit, he also published catechetical materials. There are also efforts from the church para baguhin yung simbahan, para maabot yung mga ordinary people. No? The problem is, Luther and Calvin tried to reform the church by going out of the church. Where in fact, there are people within the church like Peter Canisius who tried to reform the church from within. No? So he published Catechism in Three Forms, the Major Catechism in 1555, Minimus Catechism in 1556, this is the shortest, yung Major is the longest, and then the Minor Catechism in 1558. So the contents are about wisdom and justice, faith, open love, avoiding evil and doing good, prayer, fasting, almsgiving, virtues, evangelical counsels, and the four last things. So ito na yung mga contents na ngayon din ay present sa ating modern day catechism. So, they quickly became the Catholic catechism that time. No? Throughout the Catholic communities, Germany, and then began to be translated into other languages all over Europe. So, di ba pag minsan, yung naging term na knowing Canisius. Pag sinabing knowing Canisius, you know the Catechism of Canisius. Parang bang knowing Benedict, yung mga thinker, no? O kaya knowing Karl Rahner. So one can find catechism-like fragments throughout church history simply because catechesis is found throughout church history. Yung catechism ay hindi lang ito nag-emerge during the time of John Paul II, no, or the Council of Trent, pero it is present ever since, even the time of the Jewish people up until now. So what really makes the catechism take off, however, is the Protestant Reformation. Before Luther, as early as the 14th century, it had regularly been recognized that catechesis was essential to reform the church. Mamaya, may mababanggit ako din about this. Take note of this. Kasi, babalikan ito ni Pope Francis doon sa kanyang Evangelii Gaudium. No? That catechesis is essential in reforming the church, in the church renewal. It's very essential. And that's why the role of catechists now and all the catechetical ministry in all our dioceses is very essential in church renewal. So, the Council of Trent in 1500s promulgated a Catechismus Romanus. But this catechism is not actually a catechism in the ordinary sense of the word because it is actually for the clergy. Catechismus ad parochos, no? To enable them to catechize these, those entrusted to their spiritual care. Ewan ko kung paano makuha itong mga materials na ito. Baka meron si Monsignor Jerry dito, catechism ng Council of Trent. Kasi, it's very important kasi it is directed sa mga pare, mga parish priests especially. No? Ewan ko, baka ang simbahan magandang magkaroon din ito eh, yung catechism for priests. Kasi the Council of Trent saw this already, the importance, the significance of, you know, instructing the clergy about the importance of catechesis. So the Council of Trent, sanctioned by the authority of the Holy Synod, that meron dalawang pinag-uutos ng matindi, malupit sa mga kaparehan. Parish priests and all others has a duty of imparting instruction to edify the faithful. Second, to have one common rule and prescribed form of delivering the faith and instructing the Christian people on Christian piety. So ito yung dalawang major role of the priests in the parish. So the composition of the work was entrusted to four distinguished theologians, two of them archbishops and one a bishop. Under the supervision of three cardinals, the original draft was turned to the elegant Latin by Pugianus and Manutius. This version was translated by command of Pope Pius. So St. Charles Borromeo was the presiding spirit of the Council of Trent.
Queen George.
Carlos Borromeo. So, Cardinal Bellarmine's catechism was ordered by Clement VIII for papal estates. So the catechism, baka may gumagamit pa sa inyo ng Bellarmine catechism. This is instructed by Pope Clement. This is for the papal estates. Yung kaya medyo mataas. So una, dalawang catechism yung nagawa ni Cardinal Bellarmine. First is the Dottrina Christiana Breve. And this is for scholars. So the method is the teacher asks questions and the scholar replies. Ito yung method ni nung una, Dottrina Christiana Breve. And then the other one was published after a year. This is for teachers naman. So the scholar asks the questions and the teacher replies. So you see the method. So ibang method naman ito yung ginamit ni Cardinal Bellarmine. Of course, the Lasal, wala na siya na. The Brothers of the Christian Schools, founded by St. John Baptist de la Salle, devoted themselves especially to religious as well as secular instructions, finding that the very poor were unable to attend school on weekdays. So the saintly founder introduced secular lessons on Sundays. This was in 1699, nearly a century before such teaching was given in Protestant England. So imagine, ito yung mga initiatives coming from the church herself. To reach out to ordinary people, to instruct them about the faith and morals. During the 18th century, Pope Benedict XIII, pero dito ko yung bakit si Pope Benedict XVI is very, ano, very doctrinal at saka very love niya talaga yung catechesis, issued 3 ordinances prescribing in detail the methods, division into small classes, and special preparation for confession and communion. Then Pope Clement XIII, against the rationalistic tendencies in the pedagogical movement of the century, he uttered a protest in 1761. Kasi masyado na, ito na yung time na nagiging yung rationalism, no? Na pati yung evangelization efforts becomes like that the method is too rationalistic. Nalilimutan na yung yeah, the experiential, no? Lumulutang na. So Pope Pius VI wrote in 1787 to the Orientals proposing for their use of catechism in Arabic prepared by the propaganda team. Let's go to the 19th century. Very, very exciting, interesting. Kasi si Napoleon, he imposed upon all the churches in France a uniform catechism. Why? Because of his personal agenda. Kasi yung French Empire, gusto niya, itinagdag niya, isiningit niya yung imperial catechism. Paano mo ititreat yung emperor? Paano mo, lahat, pati yung nilagyan niya ng catechism, no? Even though against ito dun sa Pope, ginawa pa rin niya ito sa French Empire. Kasi para pag kinukonsider yung sarili niya as a deity. So Vatican Council, the First Vatican Council in 1869 to 1870, the question of having a single universal catechism was discussed. But there was great diversity of opinion among the fathers of the council. And consequently, the discussion led to no result. So wala pa rin nagawang official na uniform catechism even during the time of the First Vatican Council. So meron, depende sa local churches, sa mga particular churches, yung mga dioceses and mga parishes. Ito na yung Vatican Council, the Second Vatican Council. This is pivotal in the new evangelization effort. Kasi, di ba si Pope John XXIII, he wants to see the church's relevance in the modern world. It is already 1965, actually, Vatican II is trying to respond to the demands of the modern world. But 1962 is already post-modern. Parang late pa rin. No? But not bad. At least the church is trying to make herself relevant, no, sa panahon. So, it's actually already postmodern. So, that there are two movements that John XXIII did in order to see the relevance of the church. First is the Risorgimento, and then the second is Aggiornamento. Risorgimento is a French term, which means going back to the roots, to the origin. And the origin is the scripture. So, go back to the scripture. Babalik kaya, the Vatican II documents are actually founded on the scriptures. And adjournment is updating, to be updated. Ano na ba ang nangyayari sa is looking back and looking forward. No? So, alam natin yan. Ito yung malaking mahalagang aspeto sa kasaysayan ng ating simbahan, especially sa modernong panahon. Tatalon tayo sa time ni Pope John Paul II. So, lapasan natin si Paul VI, si John I, and then we go to John Paul II. So he was elected on the third day of the conclave in 1978 and served as the head of the Catholic Church until his death in 2005. Mahalaga kasi noong ma-elect si Pope John Paul II, 1978, ano na kaya ang generation nito? Sabi natin yung Vatican II trying to respond to the demands of the modern times. Eh, yung 1960s, postmodern na. Eh, ano pa yung time ni John Paul II? So, sa time ni John Paul II, so after the Synod of Bishops in 1985, the decision to publish a catechism was approved. Ayun na sa wakas. Yung failure ng First Vatican Council ay nagkaroon na ng success during the time of John Paul II. No? Na magkaroon ng, nagkasundo na rin sa wakas. So in 1986, the commission was created with 12 bishops and cardinals as in charge of the project. So the text was approved by Pope John Paul II on June 25, 1992. So the catechism of the Catholic Church that we are using was promulgated only during the time of John Paul II in 1992, during the 30th anniversary of the opening of the Second Vatican Council. And the Latin Typical Edition was promulgated in 1997 with the amended contents and the inclusion of the position on death penalty. So it was amended in 1997 just for one, for important reason. They have to include in the catechism the position of the church about death penalty. Kasi yung una na inilabas ay walang statement about death penalty. So imagine, so after 1997, kailangan namang i-revise yung mga naunang pinalabas. So the revision should be patterned after the 1997 Latin Typical Edition. Kaya minsan nakalagay doon from the original, from the Latin Typical Edition. Kasi merong ginawang amendment doon sa catechism. Let's talk about the generation. So nung si Pope John Paul II was elected Pope, tingnan natin, medyo malabo, no? Yung daw mga ipinanganak before 1945, ang tawag sa kanila mga maturists. Meron po ba rin ito pinanganak noong 1945? Meron na. Wala kasi ba? Meron po? Wala pa.
Monsi.
So, yung formative experience ng mga ipinanganak ng pre-1945 hanggang 1945, yung Second World War, no, yung fixed gender roles, rock and roll, nuclear families, defined gender roles. No? So basically, and then ano yung aspiration ng mga maturist? Home ownership, attitude toward technology, largely disengaged. Kaya we do not expect na yung mga 1945 people ay techie. No, wala, they are totally disengaged. Then attitude toward career jobs are for life. Signature product, automobile, communication media, formal letter. Sulat. Love letter, ayan. Communication preference, face-to-face, and preference when making financial decisions, face-to-face meetings. Okay, kailangan mag-usap tayo personal. Mukha sa mukha. Then, yung pinanganak ng 1945 to 1960, ang tawag sa kanila baby boomers. Baby boomers, ano yung formative experiences nila? Yung Cold War, post-war boom, swinging 60s, Apollo moon landing, youth culture, Woodstock, family-oriented, rise of the teenager. So ano yung aspiration naman nila? Job security. Attitude toward technology, early information technology, mga IT adapters itong mga ito. Attitude toward career, organizational careers are defined by employers. Ano na yung signature product ng time nito? O meron ng television? Black and white. O kaya pulay blue. Di ba yun po? Nagtatamani mo pa padayo ko. Okay. And then, communication media. Ito, meron na yung telephone. Yung tipong ipihit mo pang gano'n, pinipihit-pihit pa. Nabutan ko ba yun? Yung may pinipihit pa gano'n. Okay. Tapos, communication preference, face-to-face pa rin. Ideally, but telephone or email if required. Bakit may email na doon, wala pa namang internet? Kasi, ibig sabihin, kasi meron pang nabubuhay ngayon na ipinanganak ng mga 1960s. Kaya sila, kaya pa nila maka-adapt doon sa pag-i-email-email, okay? So, yung mga ipinanganak naman ng 1961 to 1980, sila yung tinatawag na Generation X. Ayan, ay marami rito mga Generation X. And the formative experiences of the Generation X ay yung end of Cold War, the fall of the Berlin Wall, Reagan, no? Nandito na yung introduction of the first personal computer, early mobile technology, sa ito na, rising levels of divorce, marami. Why? Kasi 1960s, ito rin yung start ng sexual revolution. Kaya maraming cases of divorce, no? Maraming ayaw ng mag-asawa, yung feminism, so ito yung height ng mga ganitong mga worldviews. And then aspiration is work-life balance. So attitude toward technology, ito yung mga tinatawag natin mga digital immigrants. Parang mga immigrants tayo, parang medyo nagiging nag-a-adjust, no, sa digital world. So, attitude toward career, early portfolio careers, loyal to profession, not necessarily to employer. Ito sa kanyang profession, to employer. So, signature product, ito na, meron ng personal computer. Ito, meron ng computer that time, medyo, tapos yung mga printer, that matrix, tapos yung computer niya, medyo, yung nag-blink-blink-blink, pagana. Okay, and then communication media, may email na, and then meron ng text message, text ano dyan, may cellphone na yun, nag-umpisa sa beeper, tapos naging text, di ba? Yung 3315 ba yung una? 3310, yung mga antenna pa. Ayan. 3210. Wow. Yung pag naka-beeper ka, tuwang-tuwa ka na, tutulog, tinilig, social media. Naka-beeper.